Thanks for watching this video. Remember to give a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. So in this video, I've put the question here and the exam report here. So this is the question and the exam report. So today the focus, this paper is taken from the Pearson exam board, Edexcel, Economics. The paper is from 2019, okay, 2019, January. So today the topic, we'll start with question one. So the question one, okay, the topic for today will be about the basic economic problem. So that's our topic for today. So right now, so let's take a look. The first question. So the original point, equilibrium point is x. So we have to take a look at these changes, okay. So first of all, we have to take a look at the product. It's about the electric car. So let's take a look at the first one. The first one is about a rise in the wages. So when there's a rise in wages, the supply would drop, okay. So this one, the supply will shift to leftward and upward, okay. So this is the first one. So as you can see in the graph, so this is the J, okay. J would be the answer for the first one, okay, shifting from here upward and leftward. Let's take a look number two. Number two will be about demand, right? So the demand would shifts. So let's mark it down. So the demand will shift rightward and upward like this. So the answer will go to B. Let's take a look the first one, the third one. So there's a fall in consumer income. So it's again, it's about the demand, okay? Again, it's about the demand. So it will shift to, you know, leftward and downward. So the answer goes to G. Let's take a look at the last one. It's a little bit difficult, as there is an increase in subsidies for the electric car. So that means the supply would increase. So this one, the supply would increase, that will shift to the rightward and downward. The supply would go like this. And there's an increase in the tax on the petrol car. So the petrol car, I would like you to mark it down. So this petrol car, they are the subsidies. They are the subsidies to electric car. So think about it. When people buying petrol car decrease, then these people, they will shift to buy, they will shift to buy the electric car. You know, they don't buy petrol car, they will buy electric car. So the demand for electric car would increase. So we have to consider two effects. The one is about a drop in supply, and another one is about the increase in demand. Increase in supply and increasing supply and increasing demand. So the answer for this one, it goes to C. In the exam report, it talks about, okay, most answer or correct or nearly incorrect. In this part, I would like to take a look at A2 first, okay, and then we'll jump to A3. A2 talks about what supply of copper will be price elastic, okay. So this one, it talks about, okay, very difficult to... This one is about difficult to raise the quantity supplied. The quantity supplied in a short period of time. So this is, would be the skills to do it. In the textbook, it talks about it's not responsive to the price changes. So you may consider, okay, it's difficult to raise the quantity supply in a short period of time. And the reason would be it takes time, okay, this all takes time, okay, to increase the supply in the short run. So in explanation, you have to talk about why, okay, why is it so difficult to do it. Say for example, you can talk about it's difficult to find and extract, okay. So that's why people have difficulty to increase it in the short run. So in the exam report, it talks about the struggle, okay, about the PED and PES. So this is not difficult to struggle because you can see it's about supply, right? So let me explain the term clearly. For the PED, it's about price elasticity of demand. For the PES, it's about the price elasticity of supply. So as you can see here, it talks about supply, right? So this will be about supply, but not PED, okay? So and also some students, they struggle to talk about whether the demand for copper or electric cars. So it must be copper, you're talking about copper because the question stated clearly, okay? So you're not talking about the demand of copper, no, okay? You should talk about the supply, okay? It's about the supply of the copper. And it's not about the electric cars, okay? No, okay? It's not about electric cars. Okay, now let's move on to part three. The increase in the price of electric cars would therefore lead to, so this one is very easy. It depends on the price elasticity. Right now, the price elasticity is price elastic, okay? It's price elastic. So for price elastic one, that means, so the percentage increase in price is price elastic is smaller than the percentage drop in the quantity. So a bigger drop, so as you can see, there is a bigger drop. So I would say the answer goes to B, okay? The answer goes to B. There is a bigger drop in the quantity, okay? Let's take a look at part A4. We have to identify two factors that make a product price elastic. So first of all, we have to define the meaning of elasticity. So when it is called price elastic, that means percentage change in Q will be larger than percentage change in price. So there are a lot of factors that lead to it. Say for example, there are a lot of summatives, okay? And also the proportion of income. So remember when you talk about it, okay, you have to give examples. Say for example, we talk about electric cars. Then we talk about, say for example, petrol car, okay, is one of the substitutes of the electrical car. You have to give example. So in the exam report, it talks about a lot of students, they can offer the first one, but not the second one. So let's take a look at the second one. It's about the proportion of income, okay? The larger, okay, the more expensive one, they're too much for the people. So then people, they have to think about it. Let's take a look at A5. It talks about in the determination of the wage rate, the demand of labor is more important than that of the supply. So of course, in the first point, we have to talk about why, okay? Why is that? Okay, so first of all, labor is a derived demand, okay? So that means they are derived by the popular products, okay? So the wages of it will be likely higher for the popular products than those workers who face the declining products, okay? So this is the first one to talk about it. Okay, so we have to first of all talk about the demand for popular product versus product with declining demand. So this is the first way we talk about it, to why the demand is so important. So next, and then we will move on to the supply, okay? Why the supply is more important, okay? So we can talk about the skill sets, okay? The skill set, and also the employers will try to attract the workers, okay? So worker with few or no skills, they're likely to be paid low, okay, as the supply is high, okay, of course, okay. So, or you may do it this way, the one with the right skills, the supply of skilled workers are limited. Now, before we move on to the conclusion, let's take a look at this one. Let's take a look at the examination report. Only a few candidates can deliver the recent judgment. So, of course, let's take a look at the recent judgment. It depends on the type of employment, okay? So that means the skill set that we've talked about. If the high level of the skill need to be, the supply will be the determining factors, okay? If that is no skill, then the demand will be more important. So the conclusion would be, so I would like you to mark it down. So the reasonable judgment and conclusion, so this one is about the skill set, okay? This would be the answer. Let's move on to 1B1. So for 1B1, we have to point out the point that represent, underutilization resources, okay? So that must be D, okay? D must be the answer. As you can see, you can go to C or you can go to A without sacrificing, okay? Without sacrificing the others. So the answer must be D. So this one is very straightforward and easy. Now we will move on to 1B2. So we have to explain the meaning of opportunity cost. So we can make use of the CBA, okay? We can make use of the CBA. So first of all, we need to give the definition of the opportunity cost, okay? So this is the definition. We have to define opportunity cost. So the definition would be the loss of next best alternative. So after we define it, we can make use of ABC point, okay, to talk about it. Say for example, if the pawns move from C to B, then you can see we have sacrificed the consumer goods, okay, to increase the producer good. So the consumer goods would drop, okay? So the consumer goods would drop. For this one, it would drop to increase the number of capital goods. So this is what we call opportunity cost. So let's go to part three. So explain why point D is unattainable. Of course, it's because it's beyond the point, right? So this is not difficult, it's beyond the point, okay? So there are not enough resources to do that, okay? So in the examination report, okay, a lot of, when you work assertions with little development or understanding the current supply constraint. So this current supply constraint, it talks about the resources constraint, okay? So this is called the resources constraints. So let's take a look, part C1. This is a very straightforward question. It asks about, okay, what are the features of the mixed economy, okay? So that's very easy, okay? So this will be what to produce, how to produce, and for whom to produce. So the answer go to C, okay, that's a very straightforward one, okay. I would like to move on to part C2. So it talks about in the mixed economy, the larger the private one, the more efficient it will be. Do you agree? Okay, so of course, first of all, we have to define the efficiency in the market sector. Say for example, there is more competition, okay. And then cost will be driven down, okay, and result in a lower price, okay? So the efficiency lies on the profit incentives, okay? So the profit incentives will bring about two things, okay? The one, okay, is about the innovation. Number two would be about the quality. So these two, so that's what we say why the profit sector will be more efficient, okay? They will have a lower price, okay? And also the profit incentive will lead to more innovation and better quality. However, we can make use of the market failure to explain why it is net efficient, okay? So this one is related to the topic called the market failure. So in this topic, you can introduce the concept called externalities. So in externalities, we've talked about positive and negative externalities, okay? So you can talk about these, okay? And you may give examples, okay? Say for example, I would say a cigarette, okay? Say for example, cigarette, so there will be, divergence in the margin, the social cost and the private cost. So you can talk about this one as an example. So right now we will go back to the answer. So it talks about the fewer proper goods and merit goods, okay? And also, you know, competition can be wasteful, okay? So you can talk about these, okay? So right now, before we go to the 6 marks, okay, we have to take a look at the exam report. It talks about the counter argument, they are not well developed, okay? So remember, you have to talk about the merit goods and also the proper goods, okay? Yep, that's the answer. So here, to reach the consensus, of course, do you agree? Of course, no, okay? The answer must be no, okay? We do not agree. No. This is our stance. So the answer relies on number one, okay? There must be some private sector provision for the public good, okay? For the public good. Say, for example, national defense, okay? Or, you know, the street lamp, okay? Yeah, so these are examples of public goods, okay? They must be provided by the public sector, okay? And also, it depends on the regulation of the private sector, okay? Say, for example, the demurrage good, okay? How does it regulate, okay? Are there any taxes, etc.? So that's all for this video. Remember to give a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel.